Here early tonight. This is Apex Express, Asian and Pacific Islander Radio, right here on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno in the Central Valley, and online at www.kpfa.org. We have a full, fun-packed night tonight. With me here is Preeti. How you doing, Preeti?
Good, good. Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas to you and your sisters here, and so you got some of your family sharing tonight's show with us.
Yeah, my family is visiting me from India. The winter.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
So here they are watching good old USA radical radio, I guess. You know, we're going to have a packed show tonight. We're going to be hearing something about a southern comedian, in a way. I guess you could say that Dhaya is from the southern states, but her parents are from South Asia. And a little bit about Dhaya. I think you're going to, you found out a little bit about her, Preeti. What's you have anything to say about Dhaya?
Well, yeah, Dhaya is a South Asian comedian, and I have had the opportunity to attend some of her performances. And she is pretty interesting and exciting, and, you know, she comes with a, she has a diverse background in business, working in the venture capitalist, in, you know, world, and then coming, going to MIT.
So we're
going to
hear a little bit
more.
I got to go on and talk a little bit more about some other things that we're going to have tonight. We're going to have some a little guided tour, an audio guided tour through an art exhibit, but it's your average art exhibit. This is not. It is contemporary art that reveals vast changes in a vast country through visuals in the exhibit called Mahjong. And we're also going to be hearing a little bit about raising spirits in services through a youth band, Filipino American Jazz, Filipino American Jazz, the U.S. Philippine War, and a festival. So how are we going to tie this all in? Well, you can hear us talk to Bay Area musician Ben Luis. And but first off, we want to share a little bit of music with you as we're talking about Filipino American jazz musicians and jazz. This particular piece is called Love Not Them by Flip Nunez, who is a pianist. He passed away, but we haven't forgotten him. It's coming up now. This particular piece is called Love Not Then, and it also showcases George Mirabus, who is a pianist here in a band that was formed and produced by Coke Escovito. So Love Not Then, and then we'll go right into our talk about Phil-Am Jazz.
I'm hoping for a heartache.
Buena Vista United Methodist Church with longtime musician Ben Weiss. He has been studying music since he was in college at San Francisco State and has continued on for years. And the reason why we're at Buena Vista United Methodist Church is Ben is the lead bass player here in sort of a musical ensemble that plays at Buena Vista United Methodist Church. We're going to talk a little bit about that. And we're also going to talk about a Filipino jazz festival that's coming up in December. So welcome to the show, Ben Weiss.
Thank you, Jenna, for inviting me.
Now, we're sitting here in this beautiful church setting. Can you give me a little bit of an understanding about how this music performs? I don't know, is it a music? What would you call it? You're kind of the leader of the group, as I understand it.
Well, back in about 1998 or 97, Michael Yoshi, the pastor here, we connected somehow. I forgot how. But he heard me play, and he said he wanted to bring that type of music and feel to his church.
What kind of music is that?
That's a mixture of contemporary Christian songs with traditional church songs. But he wanted me to put a twist on it and add a little bit of this, a little bit of that, a little bit of Motown, a little bit of jazz, and a little bit of, you know, rock. So and I've managed to do that, and it's just wonderful, the church, and he's just so happy for it. So we're going to continue this for as long as we can.
Now, you're taking up about almost a good part of the front area of the church. So is this a regular jazz band setup, or?
Well, what happened was it evolved into what it is now. We started off about 4 or 5 people. And then it grew to up to from 12 to 16 people. So when we're all here, we got about 16 people.
But there's a lot of young people, I notice. Is that correct, that it's got that kind of a feel to it?
Yes, they like to nurture young people here. Now, I've known these kids over here. You can't see them, but they're playing music in the background. I know these kids from middle school. So, you know, we nurture them. And now some are playing in a jazz band at Alameda High School. And we just like to nurture young people, and that's our future.
So do you actually do the arrangement?
What happens is every Monday I meet with the pastor, Michael Yoshi, and he gives me songs, and he says, okay, Ben, what do you think that go with the lectionary, meaning that would go and coincide with the sermon? And I take a song and say, oh, yeah, I can put this beat here, I'll put that beat there. And me and Michael would come over here to the piano, and we'd do something and say, oh, yeah, that's it, Ben, we'll do that. So that's how we choose, and that's how we arrange it.
Now, Reverend Yossi is a very progressive reverend. So what are the kind of the issues that he talks about, that, and then you figure out the music? How do you do that?
This church, you know, we always talk about political stuff. I always talk about community things. I always root for the down out person, the homeless.
So it's totally up to you once he explains to you what a sermon's going to be, and then it's kind of like you have to think about it. You got like 3 days, or?
Yeah. I've been here over 10 years, so a lot of the songs that we play already written down and arranged. I've arranged and written out for the horns, and so it's easy. So he'll pick a song, I go, oh, good.
How would you say, what's your arrangements like?
I come from the R&B history and experience. So it's going to be R&B. And then I went in and evolved it to jazz. And we try to play these jazz songs. I try to get these kids here to practice jazz. But for me, if I'm going to present something, and you know, if it's going to be a jazz service, we're talking about a jazz service. I need to bring some jazz people who can play that. But for now, these guys are learning, and we play jazz songs, but, you know, nothing to where I want it to be. But I still encourage them, and I still help them.
Now, going back to some of the other things that you're doing, you have a gig coming up in L.A., part of the Filipino American Jazz Festival in Los Angeles. What's the scoop on that?
The Filipino musical community. I think you remember we did a Lasanong Jazz. Filipinos for Affirmative Action started that in the East Bay. But it was kind of like a small thing, but I was the first of its kind. Now, Filipino jazz musicians in L.A. heard about it, so they started 4 years ago the first Filipino jazz festival in L.A. And it's grown, and I've been invited, like I told you, to come back down this year.
Now, a little bit about the history of Filipino jazz musicians. I know Philip Nunez was a well-known piano player in the San Francisco Bay Area, came out of Stockton. George Mir was also out of Stockton, California. Folks used to play anywhere from the, you know, local jazz clubs in San Francisco to Azteca. Who are some of the other folks that you know of, Carrie, that were part of that Filipino American jazz tradition?
One was a really, really good friend of mine. His name is Rudy Tenyo. And his sister, Josie, they were kind of like my mentors, besides Flip and George. And then there was Bobby Enriquez, the madman of Manila. You know, played with all these greats, played with backed up Dizzy at one time. So, and then there's Melesio, you know, who's
the saxophonist Melesio Magdalio.
Yes, Melesio Magdalio, who's played with Pete Escobedo, and he played with just a host of people. And there's some pretty good, you know, young people coming up too. Matter of fact, in L.A., I'm going to be playing. I'm on the same bill with this guy, this Filipino brother from Chicago who won the Thelonious Monk Award for the best horn player. And this, you know, young cat, man, he's like 24 years old. So he's going to be a monster. So I'll be beating him when I go down to L.A.
How would you characterize Filipino American jazz? Is there anything you can say that has sort of a definite feel to it?
Well, you know, it's some of the stuff we played the same, but as for Filipinos, you know, Flip Nunez shaved his head bald one time and said he's not going to grow hair until he gets some kind of recognition for all the Filipinos that play in jazz. So, yeah, well, he grew his hair back, but, you know, it's just starting. Now, Filipinos are beginning to be recognized. Matter of fact, this one sister I just played with in Vallejo, her name is Charmaine Clamore. Now, she is the first Filipina or Filipino to headline Yoshi's in San Francisco. So, and that's really, I mean, that's exciting, man. You know, she's young sisters, you know, like in her early 30s. Tremendous talent. And I had the opportunity. I've known her for 4 years. I backed her up. But that's the one we should look for, you know, look out for.
And also, I think members of the Third Wave who used to play with George Duke, I think they're playing again.
That's right.
You know what's sort of funny? Going back to Flip Nunez, I interviewed him once for KPFA. And I asked him this question about Asian American jazz. Do you consider yourself an Asian American jazz musician? You know, and his daughter was also with him on that particular interview. She's also a jazz musician and a drummer. And he used to always tell me, no, you know, I don't think I'm a, you know, Asian American jazz musician. I just want to be known as a jazz musician. So was this, did he go through some transition or something? Did he change his mind about the whole thing about recognizing? He had all of his hair then, by the way.
Right, yeah, yeah. Well, you know, Flip learned music in L.A. From all the greats down in L.A. So for him to be considered Filipino, it wasn't a time for them to think Filipino or Asian back then. It was a time for them to just get their stuff together, you know? And I think through the years, he finally said, you know, I know this, even though he didn't say it, that that Filipinos, you know, yeah, I'm a Filipino jazz musician, yeah. But back then, that was the thing. They needed to learn how to play jazz. And for a Filipino to play jazz wasn't recognized, so... But yeah, Flip, you know, before he passed, I know he was thinking, yeah, Filipino jazz musician, man. Mm-hmm. You know.
Yeah, so I think he did change. The other thing too about that Filipino jazz festival in L.A. Now, is that going to happen every year? And who else is involved in it?
Yeah, it's going to happen every year. It's fourth annual coming up this the 27th, December 27th.
Some of the other people that are playing with you down there, who are they?
Okay, so I know all of them. Mon David, he's a singer. He in 2006 he won the best singing award in England. So, and then there's this young cat, Julius Tolentino from New York. They're bringing him down from New York, and of course they're bringing that guy from Chicago. Erbegon is his last name, and they're bringing me from San Francisco.
What's the name of your band that's going down there?
My band is for this venue is called Ben Louis Collective. It's going to be one name is Chris Planas, guitar player, Kenny Penalver on the keyboards, Neil Flores on percussion, myself on bass, Tim Vaughn on the drums, and then for this collective thing, my son Paulo is going to go down and he's going to do some spoken word with my band, and also Carlos Zielcita, who's the president of the San Francisco Filipino American Jazz Festival. He's going to go down as one of my collective playing the harmonica.
Wow. So what kind of music would you characterize it? Are they all originals that you're going to be playing?
Yes. Yes. When my band plays, especially in festivals or concerts, I like to do my originals.
And what kind of sound is it?
Well, that's a good question. It's a mixture. It's actually a lot of stuff. It's a lot of funk. There's a lot of jazz straight ahead. There's a lot of Latin, sambas, bassas, boleros. Actually, in almost in the Latin vein. But I do love funk, and there's some funk in my songs.
Mm-hmm. Just out of a curiosity, was Latin music in the Philippines and Latin music here? Are they kind of running parallel in terms of their history of development and the popularity? Because, you know, of Spain's and the Philippines relations has been very convoluted over the years. But, yeah, that Spanish influence has been there, like it's been in Latin America.
Yeah. I don't really know. Back in the day, Filipinos learned jazz from the Buffalo Soldiers who came from here.
African American soldiers.
They were here to fight the Filipino American War, you know, back in 1899. So they brought that music there. Now maybe Latin music somehow reached Cuba, of course, and then you got people who travel and play, these minstrels, they travel and maybe introduced that to the Philippines. I don't know how early it reached there, but yeah, we embraced it definitely. But the Philippines was from kulintang, gongs, and rhythms, and shakers, and drums.
Do you incorporate any of that into your music, or is that too difficult to do at this point, the kulintang?
Well, you know, I wanted to do some kulintang extended stuff. I have that in my first album, my first CD. I have my son playing with one of Kalandunyan, who's the master of... of the kulintang, one of his students, and my son, who actually took lessons from Colin Doolin. They opened my CD with a cleansing sort of sound of some rhythms in a kulintang rhythm.
Yeah, you're talking about Danongong Colin Doolin, who's one of the masters of that kind of style here in the United States, if not... he's from the southern part of the Philippines. What's the name of that CD? And do you have another CD coming up?
Yeah, the one I have right now is Serenade. It's called Serenade the Night. Working on my second CD, yes, and it's going to be coming out hopefully by next Christmas. I'm a little older and I've experienced more, and I gotta incorporate that with the songs.
What about how people can get a hold of you? You have any contact numbers?
If you want to hear my stuff, you can go to cdbaby.com and enter Ben Luis, and then you'll hear my stuff and see some pictures and stuff like that.
Maybe you can spell your name.
Ben Luis, B-E-N, Luis, L-U-I-S.
Okay. And do you have any contact number for the Filipino American Jazz Festival?
Actually, you can go to... mbluisjr@aol.com, and I can send you a lot of more information on that the LA Jazz Festival. Okay. Yeah, it's the fourth annual Filipino American Jazz Festival.
Okay, Ben, thanks so much for giving your time to this interview.
Well, thank you very much. I appreciate
it. Okay. And you've been listening to Apex Express. Ben Luis on the air just a little bit ago. And if you're interested in learning more about the Filipino American Jazz Festival, you can go to this website, www.jazzphil-usa.com. Again, that's jazzphil-usa.com. And John Irabagon is going to be playing there. He is the winner of the saxophone category of the Thelonious Monk competition. So if you're interested in that, you can always check that out. And we are also listening to some music again from the group Azteca, which featured Flip Nunez. This is his composition, Nonfayam, along with George Mirabus is also on this. Coke Escovedo leads the group with a lot of great musicians like Mel Martin and Victor Pantoja, so many people. This is G on KPFA and KPFA in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org. The time is 7:21. If you want to get a hold of us, you can do so by going to apex@kpfa.org, or you can call us at 510-848-6767, extension 464. 510-848-6767, extension 464. Just a little bit of music. We're going to go right into a Southern comedian. Learn more about Dhaya in just a second. And we're right back with you. We want to take a little bit of time off. You know, it's the holidays. We have a comedian, a Southern girl from the southern part of the U.S. Her parents are from South Asia. And with me tonight is Preeti, who has heard Dhaya perform. Dhaya, are you there from Southern Cal?
I am. Thank you for having me.
And are we right when we say you are kind of a Southern musician in a certain funny way and manner?
Yes. I grew up in Alabama.
Hey, Dhaya?
Yes.
Welcome on Apex Express. Can you hear me?
Thank you. Yes, I can hear you.
All right. I want to get you talking more about your multiple avatars, but before that, I want to read a little bit of your bio. I think it would be very interesting for our listeners. So, and then you can delve into it. So Dhaya has traveled to Cuba as a researcher, worked as a venture capitalist in Silicon Valley, has taught charm school to MIT engineers, and attended the Democratic National Convention as a journalist before starting in the funny business of comedy. And she's been chosen to be part of the National Five Funny Females and Pundits with Punchline Tours. She's performed in showcases around the country, such as the San Francisco Punchline, the San Jose Improv, the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, and the Comedy Store in Los Angeles. She's performed for journalists in New York City and various events, and was a finalist at the Rooster T. Feathers Comedy Competition, and won third place in the 2008 Harvey's Political Comedy Competition and first place in the 2007 Battle of the Bay Competition. Wow, that's an impressive bio.
That's great.
That's just a portion of what you sent me. Wow.
It's for the South Asians who want to see the resume.
So, tell us about growing up in the South, and how was it growing up in a South Asian, South Indian household in the South?
Yeah, so my parents are immigrants from India, and I grew up in Alabama. And so I would have to really bridge the cultural gap and try to tell my mom. And at one point I said to her, you know, Mom, now that you live in the South, you should really know how to pronounce the name of your local video store. And she just looked at me and she goes, yes, I know, Blackbuster. And I was like, no, Mom, that's the name of the police station. It's Blockbuster. So it made a lot of funny moments that Mark Twain actually said that, humor doesn't come from joy, it comes from sorrow. So even though this wasn't sorrow, it actually made for some funny moments to have that juxtaposition there.
Great. And MIT, charm school, how was that?
It was interesting. My parents wanted me to go somewhere where there are lots of Indian boys who are too afraid to touch me, so they sent me to MIT. And people didn't really have the most brilliant social skills there, and we weren't really tough kids. We had like a football team, but it wasn't Division One or Division Two. It was in our own division, 3.14159. And I think our cheer was something super weird, like, don't be average, be to the right of the normal distribution. And nerds would get all excited and be like, oh, go team, go MIT. So it was a unique place to be, and I got involved with charm school because there was a dean who said that MIT students just walked down the corridors shuffling their feet, looking at their shoes, not saying hi to people. So I taught some classes and how to tell a joke, body language, and making small talk, and it ended up being a big hit, and some nerds even took notes, and they came up to me and said that they got dates because of it. So I felt like I did a community service.
So how did you transition into comedy?
It's interesting. It was almost by necessity. I spent a lot of time being the outsider. So whether that was growing up in Alabama, or being a woman at MIT, or being a venture capitalist in Silicon Valley. Pardon me. I'm losing my voice a little bit. Sorry.
That's okay. It's the holidays.
Yeah. Right. Whether it was being an outsider, it really tries to get you to be part of the community by using humor. So when I was an investor, I used humor to kind of get deals done. Or when I was at MIT, I would make people laugh. So humor is really a way to take someone who's an outsider and bring them inside. So I'd always been the funny person, and I was afraid of getting on stage and doing comedy. So at some point, I just said, I'm going to do it, and that's how I did it.
And as a South Asian woman in the field of stand-up comedy that's largely white male-dominated, how has that experience been breaking into this field so far?
Well, you're absolutely right. Stand-up comedy is largely white and it's largely male. And it's been interesting because there's definitely role models out there. Richard Pryor did not just speak to African-Americans. He spoke to all people. And Bill Cosby is one of the most beloved figures, and he's not, you know, white. Ellen DeGeneres is, you know, really, she has a popular show, and people just gravitate towards and they love her. And none of these people you would think are the traditional white male, you know, funny people. So there's role models out there. But it's also tough. People judge people very, very quickly. And especially if you're under the gun to make people laugh, when someone sees you and you're petite or you're a woman or you have dark skin, they're like, this person can't be funny. They're probably inhibited or shy or whatever. But that's also what makes it valuable, because when I go up on stage, it's almost like if you've ever played softball, where the pitcher kind of looks at the outfield and has them all walk in 2 or 3 feet because the person up to bat's a girl or she can't hit very far. It's almost that feeling when you're on stage. People don't expect you to be what you're going to be. And then once I open my mouth and start talking about things, people are like, wow, that was really funny. So it's like the Bush presidency, low expectations, and then, you know, it's hard to disappoint people after that.
And what is the market for South Asian comedians? How has it changed, especially in the last few years?
Yeah, there really is a market out there for South Asian humor. South Asians tend to be one of the ethnic groups that has large disposable income. So, you know, obviously people...
But very stingy though, right?
Yeah. You know, I'm glad you said it, not me. But it's hard being an artist because...
Pretty I'll... South Asian, by the way.
What's that?
Pretty, the co-host of South Asian, by the way.
Absolutely. I could tell from her name. So, you know, in our community... you know, people have disposable income, and they're just dying to be entertained. And Russell Peters really paved the way for some people to think of humor coming from our community. At the same time, as Preeti pointed out, you know, I'll approach an organization that's already hired a belly dancer, a samosa truck, and, you know, juggling kulfi vendors, but they can't pay for comedy. And it's interesting because we as artists have to sort of stand up and say, you know, comedy is worth paying for, and we sort of have to have an alliance and be like, there's a market for this and you need to pay us. But other than that, the community has been extremely supportive, especially women come up to me after shows, and they're like, what you're doing is great. How can we get involved? How can we support you? So people have been really, really forthcoming with whatever they can offer, and it's been great to see so many people saying, hey, you're doing something different. How can we help you?
Right, and I just wanted to clarify, when I said stingy, I meant in terms of supporting local arts and creative things. It's changed now. It's changing now. But that's what I, you know, that's what I meant when we said, when I said that the South Asian community is largely stingy. So
believe me, I'm a comedian. I can take a joke, especially one that is based in reality.
Yeah.
So it's true, because our community pretty much were, you know, immigrants who came to the United States with very little money. Many people came as, you know, students or engineers and whatnot. And also, it's cultural to haggle at the open-air market. So getting a bargain is part of South Asian culture. And, you know, our community is changing in that we can't bargain with artists, because what artists produce is invaluable. It helps society. It helps people let off steam. It brings joy to people. So in the community, we have to start recognizing art for art's sake. And stand-up comedy is a dying art form. It's just you and the microphone and a stage. You don't have a band behind you. You don't have, you know, monkeys or, you know, things to distract the audience if something doesn't work.
Right. And I want to also move on to talk about why you're here today, to tell us about your upcoming show.
Yeah, absolutely. We have a show at Rooster Teeth Feathers on December 28th, and my voice will be fine by then. But you can go to www.roosterteethfeathers.com. And if you scroll down to calendar, you can see Home for the Holidays, which is a show. It's going to be a great show for people who are around for the holidays. The headliner is Joe Klosik. He's a good friend of mine. He's been on Comedy Central, Live at Gotham. There's also Larry Bubbles Brown, who's been on Letterman a couple of times. You know, these are two white guys, but, you know, white guys can be our friends, too. They've both been great mentors. So I'm the host and MC of the show. Rooster Teeth Feathers is in Sunnyvale. It's a fantastic venue, and there's a lot of people in our community, the South Asian community, who come out to these shows, but also a lot of tech professionals, so it's a perfect audience for me. So the tickets are $12, so go to the website and check it out.
Great. And Dhaya, talking to you, I wanted to get your sense about one more issue about with the new government that's taking over in January. How do you feel in terms of, I felt that with the current government, comedians had it very hard, given how, you know, with the election campaign and so on. What is your sense? Are you more optimistic? Is there more scope for comedians and not politicians being comedians?
Well, you know, that's awesome, because during the Bush administration, we just had so much material. Mm-hmm. It was almost as if, you know, God handed us a basket of gold and said, here, go have fun. So it was great to be a comedian in the Bush administration, not as a citizen. Now my political beliefs are coming out. But the election was great, too. I mean, we had Sarah Palin and John McCain. So all that's, you know, over a little bit. I think comedians are really trying to feel out what the Obama administration is going to bring. And some people are a little hesitant to go after him, because he represents hope, he represents change, and that's really what we want. But Barack Obama has a great sense of humor. I've met him, I've heard him speak, he makes fun of himself all the time. So I think we'll still have room to make fun of the administration and the things that we do. For example, you know, who he's having you know, officiate at the inaugural, that could be potential fodder. So, you know, at some point, it's going to happen that we take on even Barack Obama, and that's the great thing about comedy. There's no rules, except you got to just make people laugh. So if you can do that, then it's okay, and it doesn't matter who you take on or what you say, just keep it funny.
Great. Thank you, Dhaya. And just a reminder that Dhaya's show on Sunday, December 28th, is happening in Sunnyvale. And tickets are available at roosterteethfeathers.com.
Yep, that's right.
All right. Thank you so much, Dhaya, for joining us on Apex Express today.
Thank you very much, Preeti.
Thank you. And we are going to go right into some Christmas music. I hope you enjoy it. We'll be right back here on Apex Express. KPFA in Berkeley. KPFB in Berkeley. and KFCF in Fresno, and online at www.kpfa.org, where you can listen to our shows online, going back for 2 years, online anytime at www.kpfa.org. This is Apex Express. And if you go to Apex Express, you can see all the stuff we've been doing. So enjoy, and I got to play this. I'm sorry. I love this Mel Torme jazz Christmas song done by a Japanese group that made it big in the Latin sound scene, Orquesta de la Luz.
Tiny cats with their eyes on a drum will find it hard to sleep tonight. They know that death is on its way. These are the last of toys and goodies on display. And every mother's child is gonna spy to see if reindeer really know how to fly. And so I'm offering this simple phrase to kids from 1 to 92. Although it's been said many times, many ways, Merry Christmas to you.
Apex Express right here on KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. You can listen online at any time at that kpfa.org site. This is Apex Express. My name is G. We are listening to Orquesta de la Luz off of their CD, Feliz Christmas. And just want to also say Feliz Navidad to all y'all out there. Also, a little bit of information about events that are happening in the Bay. Lots of times to see a lot of our art exhibit in museums. It's a perfect time for the break, full-time family events. This year there's going to be a New Year's Eve fundraiser party for Eastside Arts Alliance also, which is a community center that hosts so many youth programs, music performances, the weekly film showing, special discussions. It is a very special space in a very underserved community out here in East Oakland, but it is one of the most diverse communities in the United States. So they are having a New Year's Eve events party fundraiser. For more information, you can go to www.eastsideartsalliance. Again, that's www.eastsideartsalliance.com. And also, again, going back to the holidays and good time to do some fun educational-type events. There is so much going on, especially around Asian American arts and experiences, from labor history to the civil rights struggles, especially at Cal State East Bay Hayward. There are several exhibits about Chinese Americans. Ghost of the Dam reveals the story of Chinese workers at Lake Chabot, and Chinese workforce in Iroquois California history is almost unknown except for the railroads, but they built so much. They built the vineyards. So Ghost of the Dam, an exhibit at Cal State East Bay Hayward, and you can go to this, you have to call this number, 510-885
515-885-3299. That's 510-885-3299. Also, remembering 1882, the year of the Chinese Exclusion Act, which barred them from entering the United States. And again, that's an exhibit put on by the Chinese Historical Society. For more information, for this, you can go to 510-885-3058. All at Cal State University of East Bay in Hayward. And in addition, there are student alumni art exhibits also at Cal State University East Bay, which shows the experience post the Exclusion Act and so much more. And as I go into talking about these exhibits, etc., we have something to offer you. It's sort of like an audio tour that I took, and it's 40 years of history. That opens up in a very small space at the Berkeley Art Museum, but what a space it is. It is a visual display of vast changes taking place in a vast country in China. So check it out and go on an audio tour with me.
There's a whole bunch of propaganda posters from the Mao period.
I'm here at the Berkeley Art Museum and am on a tour of an exhibit here called Mahjong, Contemporary Chinese Art from the Sea Collection. And believe me, it is contemporary. It is posters, pictures, installations dating from the mid-60s during the Cultural Revolution up until the present. And it really runs the gamut from that period of revolution and fever to revolution and capitalist sort of fever.
Actually, Mao's images was under very specific prescripts, and his wife actually wrote out the dictates of how he would appear.
And if you really want to see how the country has changed in such a small period of time, this is the exhibit to go to. And in a way, it kind of marks the change or the changing ways that the U.S. and China relate to each other. And you can go to the bottom of the exhibit, and in the basement there are pictures from the Cultural Revolution when the U.S. and China was on a face-off because of, the United States was bombing Southeast Asia and China was emerging out of a colonial state, and all the way up into the present period where, again, maybe the U.S. and China are in a really controversial relationship and where capitalism has become the way and means of competing with each other.
And it's done by Xu Bing in 1989. What's your impression?
So again, this is the Berkeley Art Museum, and I am on a guided tour with our guide, Namiko Kunimoto, who is a student, an art student here at the University of California in Berkeley.
I was asking what your impression.
It's an amazing look at, again, about 35 years of history squeezed into a very small space.
They look like very important historical documents, and they remind me of something that you might see, say, in...
And one of the first things that catches our eye are these books, but inside the books are character writing, which are ideographs, but I can't recognize any of them.
Prescripts from religion or all kinds of documents like that, but in fact, these are all artificial characters. And that seems like sort of just a strange, ludicrous idea to do until you consider that the Chinese characters have about 5,000 of them. And so to try and make characters that aren't actual characters is quite an endeavor into itself. And they actually thought that there might be a secret curse embedded within the text. But, and the government didn't support the work at all, actually. But that doesn't seem to be the case. In fact, calling it Book from the Sky suggests something a little bit more positive. And Xu Bing did spend years of his life making woodblock prints that he carved himself to make these kinds of characters. And they're sort of making us think about what history means, what archiving means, particularly in the case of documentation in Chinese writing.
On the next level of the Berkeley Art Museum, and this contemporary art features 141 works by 96 artists, including paintings, drawings, sculptures, and believe me, this is not the old-style, beautiful, but old-style traditional watercolor paintings, but they do draw from that tradition.
Pay attention to this work here. This is by Zhang Huan, and this is a performance piece called Family Tree. Now, Zhang Huan does some very, very sort of avant-garde, cutting-edge type performance work. There's another piece where he hangs himself upside down and puts a cut in his arm and lets the blood drip onto a heating pad and it sears up. And another one where he's gone into a public latrine and covered himself with fish oil and honey until flies sort of cover every inch of his body. And this one is a little bit more palatable. But again, if you look to the far right, you can see again this notion of the self being entirely covered over. So what's happening here is he has three different calligraphers work on his face. And they start off on his forehead telling an ancient Chinese fable. And then they start working around some of the features, for example, birthmarks on his face. And there's a kind of fortune-telling you can do in China that's based on these sorts of features. So what Xiangwan is really playing with is the idea of how one's ancestry and one's destiny can sort of encompass and take over the notion of individuality. So it sort of hangs in the balance there, this feeling of fate versus individuality, when you can sort of see his eyes still at the very end, but nothing else remains.
They're drawing from so many traditions. It's amazing here. This is work, again, that runs through January the 4th here at the Berkeley Art Museum. But on this level, we're looking at a model of Tiananmen Square, and it's sort of a clay model, a mini clay model of one of the biggest squares in the world, if not the biggest square in the world. It can hold 1 million people. And this particular square, it sort of shows from like the period of when the revolution happened through the student protests of Tiananmen and then to Godzilla.
Everything in this gallery is basically makes some reference to Tiananmen Square, as you can see. I'll start you off by looking at this work, which is called Parade, and this is by Zhou Shuanhui, I believe. And this is a really kind of attractive piece for our viewers because it has this real three-dimensional quality where you can sort of envision yourself within the space of the field. But it's also rather old-fashioned in a sense because it has this diorama quality, which was a way they used to explicate history before. It's very historical in a certain sense and very imaginative in another sense. It starts off with the beginning of the Communist Party here and then moves on to represent things like the Cultural Revolution, and you can see that some figures are being picked out and sort of punished for whatever crimes they may or may not have done. More and more sort of imaginative until it's covered over by the arena of Godzilla and UFOs. And so there's a number of different ways to interpret how the artist pictures 2049. One, it could be that the notion that China is really going anywhere, and certainly by looking at the media today, we get that sense that there's a lot of there's an exploding horizon of possibilities within China, and perhaps that's what the artist is speaking to. Or again, he could be playing with these ideas about history that we've been seeing coming up again and again, where history is sort of unstable and where it may seem very easy to document and lay down. In another sense, it has this very imaginative quality. It's a video you can hear in the background, and that's a sort of animated version of the figures as well.
In this collection, Mahjong Contemporary Chinese Art from the SIG Collection here at the Berkeley Museum, there is a lot of new works that show sort of the consumerism that has taken over the country. And that's quite a great leap from the way it was in the 60s.
2005. Have any of you had the opportunity to go to China before? Yes, recently or no? Well, when I was there, I was certainly overwhelmed by the number of changes that were taking place in the city, so much so that I really felt the ground beneath my feet was shifting almost constantly, and it was very hard to orient yourself because everywhere you looked, you would see buildings like this. Buildings under construction, new sites being made, new zones, all these kinds of things. And from an artwork, we may look at this piece and think, oh, it's like an administrative building or it's in a very important site. But actually, it's called Beijing No. 5, and the writing just refers to a construction company. So basically, it's a generic building that would be ubiquitous in China these days and sort of is sort of a different sort of landscape portrait.
It has commercial purpose.
Different kinds of possibilities in terms of capital. But this doesn't necessarily mean there was a lot of political change. So there's always that tension that's been existing and going on. And you can see some of that coming to the fore in a work like this. This is Wang Jin's work. Now this one is actually a commission by a department store that opened up in Zhengzhou. Has anyone been to Zhengzhou? It's a very kind of illustrious city. When I visited the National Gallery there, everything was just sparkling new with very modern architecture and automatic everything. And here they have a department store that's been commissioned, and what Wang Jun chose to do is to take commercial goods like cell phones and jewelry, and then he placed them in these ice blocks and invited city dwellers to come and get the goods. And basically, of course, they tore it apart in minutes and got their goods. And you would imagine probably if you were to install such a thing in Sather Gate on campus that the students would probably have the same kind of riotous joy about getting these goods. But certainly there is this notion that commercial goods have a very strong value.
Well, this other...
But one thing
picture.
I do like also about this photograph.
Again, it sort of draws on the older Chinese art form of watercolor type of ink painting. But instead of the mountains and the water, in the mountains, it's human bodies and their hair that's sticking out. That kind of their human bodies are kind of folded over and bent over to kind of look like mountains. It really does look like mountains.
Highly publicized image of the show, for better or worse. There's a genre called Shan Shui landscape, which basically means mountain and water landscapes. Now, when I was being trained, the curator said, well, this is a portrait of me. And I said to my fellow tour guides, I'm not sure those are all knees, but... But certainly there's this sort of tension between naturalism and pollution of the body. You can see there's like mosquitoes and bugs sitting on top of the body parts as well. But also this feeling of what is a natural zone or a living space.
And they do have photos by Ai Weiwei, who helped do the bird's nest building for the Olympics. This next one, man, this is a lot of work.
This is Wang Jin,
it's based on a Chinese imperial, very... fancy upper class mode of dress.
One of my most favorite
and
is this
in the past
here.
It would be embroidered in silk with some fantastic designs on it.
Imperial garment that's made out of polyvinyl and fishing wire. It's a really interesting combination of materials that you would have to admit would be extremely difficult to work with. But also the materials are interesting because they sort of speak to today's and yesterday's marketplace values. Whereas at one time China's market may have been based on fishing, today certainly PVC plastic has come to be a major leader in the market instead.
The next one we see downstairs is a famous work, almost life-size men, pretty much life-size men of this artist. He's smiling, and it's kind of a takeoff on the thousands of soldiers that were found buried in the tomb of, I believe, the Qing emperor.
Quite famous, these Yeomanjun statues. And these are apparently supposed to be made in Yeomanjun's likeness. His face is very similar to this as well. And a lot of talk has been about the way it sort of represents tensions between the individual and the masses. But I also think it has a lot of art historical importance as well. There was another artist in 1989 who was a very important Chinese contemporary artist, and he was kicked out of his art academy because he was told that his work was too sullen and too sad, and that he had to make more positive work. So he came up with this painting of this just hugely garish grin, and that seems sort of like empty and hollow. And you can see that Yeomanjun is sort of picking up on this as well. And there's another sort of very important archaeological event that I think this refers to, and that would be the Terracotta Warriors. It certainly looks
the
like
last part of this particular exhibit I go and visit on my own. It's sort of off to the corner here, and on one side it's sort of a video thing happening, installation. On one side of the corner is a video of Chinese soldiers. It looks like a propaganda piece, again, from the 60s, and wave upon wave of Chinese soldiers are confronting the imperialists. And on the other side of the corner on the wall is another video of U.S. soldiers, again, doing the same thing. So I'm not sure what it means. There's not much explanation. But again, the United States now has kind of this interesting relationship with the country. Maybe it means, isn't the United States going to face China as an ally, a friend, or a capital competitor? All these things are up for grabs. But this particular exhibit at the Berkeley Art Museum, Mahjong, called Mahjong, Contemporary Art from China, is going to be up at the Berkeley Art Museum. It's going to be here through January the 4th. go to this particular website, which is www.bampfa.berkeley.edu. Again, that's bampfa.berkeley.edu. And the telephone number is 510-642-0808. Again, 510-642-0808. And it might be a good idea to call them given the holiday hours. My name is G, here for KPFA and Apex Express. And speaking about the holiday hours, with me here, my name is G. It's Preeti. And her family is visiting from India. I hope they like their stay here. Hope they're enjoying their time here in our Berkeley station at Northern Cal. We have a little bit of information. Preeti has one more piece of calendar events. This is KPFA and KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. This is Apex Express. If you want to get a hold of us, you can go to apex@kpfa.org. Or you can call us at 510-848-6767, extension 464. I want to say you can listen online by going to that kpfa.org address. And our show goes back 2 years. Just go to programs and it's listed there alphabetically. And also, if you want to hear or see more articles, you can go to our website, which is apexexpress.org, APEXEXPRESS, with DJ Crush in the background. Preeti, you got some information for us.
Yes, I do. This is the 9th Annual South Asian Literary Association, or SALA, conference that's happening in San Francisco tomorrow and the day after. That is the 26th and the 27th. This conference this year is themed around gender and sexuality in South Asian literature and culture, and has interesting and exciting papers and readings on South Asian literature, criticism, film, cultural and social activism. And tomorrow evening there is this exciting event I want to invite our listeners to. It's called Hamara Mushera, and it is the evening program of this conference, and it's happening at the Galleria Park Hotel tomorrow evening from 8 to 10:30 p.m. That's on 191 Sutter Street in San Francisco. And this program has readings by different South Asian writers, including Farzana Doctor, who's based in Toronto, author of Stealing Nasreen, and Chicago-based writer Mary Ann Mohanraj, and also a local Bay Area-based writer, Meenal Hajratwala. Again, the event is called Hamara Mushera, and it's happening at the Galleria Park Hotel tomorrow from 8 to 10:30 p.m.
And like I said, I cannot help but play this next piece. This is a group from Japan. It is Christmas music. It's Christmas Day here in the States, if you're listening overseas in Japan. But Merry Christmas to everybody, and we're going to go out with some music by Orquesta de la Luz, again, a group from Japan that hit it big on the salsa scene in English, Spanish, of course, and a little bit of Japanese. So we're going to go out with their Feliz Christmas CD. So check us out every Thursday here on 94.1 FM in Berkeley, KPFB in Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. My name is G. Thanks for listening.